Visit Equalising for divers. This presentation is a brief introduction to give you the skills to perform ear equalising in a way that will make your diving both enjoyable and safe. The important part of ear equalisation is the middle ear. The middle ear is behind the eardrum and before the inner ear and is ventilated through the Eustachian tube, which opens behind the nose. This semi-closed opening is vulnerable to pressure changes, and that's the fullness you experience in a plane and certainly while diving. One of the most important assessments a diver can undergo as part of a diving medical fitness assessment is the examination of the ear. This is a cartoon of a tympanic membrane, and there's the actual picture of one. What we do during an examination is to watch whether the eardrum moves. This is the part that usually moves clearly, and in the next video clip, you will actually see both the external ear canal leading up to the eardrum. This is an external ear and ear canal. We pass the trachus, that fleshy mound. This is skin overlying cartilage with little hairs that produce the wax that doesn't protect the ear completely. And in fact, divers can sometimes get infections called swimmer's ear. And in the distance, you see the tympanic membrane or eardrum. And this is the part that actually moves as the diver equalizes. The next video clip shows you looking upwards towards the nose where the openings of the Eustachian tube are. In the middle of this image, you see a pyramid-like structure, which is the nasal septum, dividing the nose into two passages, and on both sides you see a fleshy mound with an opening in the middle, which is the opening of the Eustachian tube. In order to be able to effectively adjust middle ear pressure to increasing pressure as a diver descends, we need equalizing techniques. There are a variety of techniques and we'll spend some time explaining them, but to start with, the process of equalizing the ears is not necessarily a comfortable one. Many divers feel awkward, uncomfortable, or will start rubbing their ears. This may either be because they're not accustomed to it, or very often, it may be that they as children developed ear infections and may even have had grommets, and this has produced a bit of a fear or uncertainty about what normal feels like. In extreme cases, divers may even be vulnerable to panic, and this is something diving instructors need to look out for. Sometimes the instructions may be somewhat confusing. Don't blow too hard, or you're not blowing hard enough, you've over-equalized, and don't equalize during ascent. These are typical instructions you will receive during a scuba dive training class. What this means is that you should not force your ears to equalize, blowing harder than you would need to fill a nice large size balloon. So it's about the same pressure you would use when clearing a snorkel. Not blowing hard enough may mean that you really aren't. You might either be blowing through the mouth and not against the nose, or you may simply be a little timid. Over-equalized means that your ears are already bulging and therefore you no longer feel the difference when you blow. What then happens is as you descend, the ears will relax again and you'll have another chance to blow. This is just something you need to discover for yourself. Finally, not equalizing during ascent is of course an instruction not to hold your breath, and therefore we don't want people equalizing in this way on the way up. Besides, that's not the time you should be pushing gas into the ear, that's the time that the gas will actually start escaping from the middle ear. Squeamishness about equalizing may be a warning sign. Many divers vulnerable to anxiety or even panic may present with squeamishness about the ears. Having said that, make absolutely sure you can equalize in order to dive and dive safely. We're now going to look at different ear equalizing techniques. There is simple yawning and swallowing, which is how we equalize from day to day, but is not necessarily practical when diving. Then there's voluntary opening of the Eustachian tube, which some divers, about 10%, learn to do. The Valsalva technique is the simplest to teach, which is pinching and blowing. The Toynbee technique, which is pinching the nose and swallowing. The Frenzel technique, which is pushing the tongue at the back of the throat to actually force air into the Eustachian tube. And twitching. Let's look at these in turn. This is what happens when you swallow. The soft palate pulls upwards, and in the process, it actually opens the Eustachian tubes. You may want to try that now. Just pinch your nose and swallow, and you may notice a change in your ears. We'll explore this again when we look at the Toynbee technique in a moment. Voluntary equalizing by opening the Eustachian tubes is something that some divers discover. It's a bit like the way you would yawn in polite company. In other words, it's sort of a strangled yawn, if you'd call it that, and you notice that there's a clicking in the Eustachian tubes as the muscles orientate themselves and literally open the tube. If you can get to do this, great, but many divers don't, so don't worry. This is the technique that your diving instructor has probably taught you or will be teaching you. Notice how the video clip shows the eardrum bulging in response to the person equalizing. This particular technique can sometimes be done too forcefully or for a too long period of time, so you don't want to do it for more than about 5 seconds. The reason being that you can either force the ears, which can cause damage, or you may even pass out. So don't overdo a good thing. The next technique is the one that you may have tried earlier, which is pinching your nose and swallowing. What you may notice after you did the previous technique of pinching and blowing is that when you swallow, it actually feels as if the ears close up. That's because this technique initially opens the Eustachian tube and then milks it empty, actually showing that your Eustachian tube works in both directions, allowing air in and allowing air out. The next technique is one that's worth mastering if you can. Basically what happens, as illustrated here, is you deliberately push your tongue against the soft part of the palate and in the process reduce the volume of the nasopharynx, so that's the volume behind the nose, so that it pressurizes and literally injects air into the Eustachian tube openings. It's a bit like saying hmm or kh in the back of the throat. Something you could even try to show that you're getting this technique right is filling your mouth with water, and believe it or not, you will find that you can actually equalize by pinching the nose and using the Frenzel technique with a mouthful of water, without drowning, and without needing to blow from your chest. Try it. It's worth discovering. Many people who struggle to Valsalva do very well with the Frenzel technique. Experiment and try it out. It's something you will do most when you dive. The next technique is really just a fun way to discover your ears, and basically you pinch the nose, blow gently, not to the point of equalizing, but then just before they would pop, you turn the head to the side. What that does is it stretches the Eustachian tube and literally allows gas to escape into it. Now, if equalizing doesn't work the way it should, there's some tricks you can try. I've used the mnemonic help me to make it easier to remember. Head tilting, Edmonds, Lowry, politerization or oat events, medical assessment and ENT visits. So let's have a look. Head tilting is useful when you find, as at least half of divers do, that the one ear is easier to equalize than the other. So here's what happens. When you stretch the neck, it actually pulls down on the oropharyngeal structures, that's the space behind the tongue, and it makes it easier to equalize the ear that is, if you like, pointing upwards. Now this has got nothing to do with daylight or buoyancy, it's literally just the effect of stretching the Eustachian tube. So why not try it? Tilt your head, remember to stretch the muscles in the neck, and let the ear that is a little bit slower than the other, if you have that, point upwards. Then, using any technique you like, try to equalize. You should find the ear pointing upward now equalizes first, or at least faster than it used to. The next technique is very, very powerful, and it involves jutting your jaw forward, something you can do even with a regulator in the mouth. What that does is it tenses the jaw muscles involved with opening the jaw, and in the process opens part of the Eustachian tube. It makes equalizing easier. Try it. It really is worth doing. And then if you'd really like to just feel your Eustachian tubes open, try Christopher Lowry's technique. It involves pinching your nose, blowing gently, and swallowing at the same time. You may need to take a glass of water to make it easier. Now, for divers that struggle to equalize, rather than consider medication long term, this is a device that is available and is basically a balloon and a nozzle. Many divers find ways to improvise this technique, but essentially what is involved is inflating the balloon through the nose, and in the process both equalizing the middle ear, because the amount of pressure involved in inflating the balloon will open the Eustachian tube, but also as the balloon deflates, swallowing intermittently so that it exercises the Eustachian tube. In my experience, I've found that divers that use this device, maybe twice to three times a day for a week, find that their ears are easy to equalize and they no longer need the medication that they may have used in the past, like Sudafed or pseudoephedrine. Speaking of pseudoephedrine, we don't recommend pseudoephedrine for divers that are completely unable to equalize or have chronic or even persistent ear equalizing problems. The same is true for topical decongestants. If you find that you need to use these to dive or equalize, it may be that you just need better instruction or perhaps even an ENT intervention to make it easier. So, rather than taking pills all the time, why not see a diving doctor or call Dan? Remember, if you do use a topical decongestant, this is the area you're aiming for. So the best is actually to lie with the head tilted back, nostrils towards the ceiling, and put 2 to maybe 5 drops per nostril, allowing about 1 to 3 minutes for the decongestion to work. We do think it's a good idea if you're a little bit concerned about diving and equalizing in the beginning, but most divers don't need this long term. In any case, you shouldn't use it continuously for more than 3 to 5 days at any time. Please remember, never force your ears. Diving deeper is not going to make it easier. Rather, ascend safely, try again, but if it doesn't work, abort the dive. You can rather return another day without damaging your ears. In closing, I'm going to give you 10 tips that should help you make the most of your ears while diving. Firstly, and very simply, just blow your nose before going diving. We all accumulate some mucus, especially in dry climates, and you don't need to work through that debris to get your ears to clear, so just blow your nose. Secondly, confirm that you're able to clear before everything around the diving activity distracts you. In other words, before you have to deal with your BC or jumping into the pool or dealing with your equipment, just check that you can equalize. Thirdly, if you need to, use that topical spray before the first dive. It may just take the jitters out of the experience. Fourthly, remember to equalize regularly while descending. Don't wait for your ears to become uncomfortable. Equalize in advance. Then, you need to confirm that your ears are clearing before you go deeper. You can always use the shot line or the buoy line to steady yourself as you go down. And by the way, it's actually easy on the ears if you do so fins first, in other words, in a head upward position, rather than duck diving and having your head down. Practice with an otobint if you can get hold of one, especially if you struggle with your ears from time to time. Ensure that you or your students, if you're an instructor, do not equalize on ascent. In other words, we don't want divers to equalize by pinching the nose and blowing when they are in the process of returning to the surface, because that would be breath holding. The gas in the middle ear escapes naturally, and you shouldn't have difficulties with this. If there's a problem, like you might have with a reverse block, then just return to the surface more slowly. Take your time, especially during the shallow parts of the dive where the greatest pressure volume changes occur. Check your ears after diving, making sure that they clear easily. And in fact, we recommend that you do that for 2 hours after every dive. The reason for this is we find that after a dive, the middle ear is somewhat irritated and therefore prone to actually absorb the oxygen more quickly and cause the tympanic membrane to actually draw inwards. That may make it more difficult on the next dive. So basically what we're saying is, make sure your ears remain clear after a dive. And lastly, if you can't clear, call Dan or see a diving doctor or ENT to help you. For most divers, we find solutions. Thank you for listening to this. We hope it'll add to your diving joy and experience and certainly make it safer. And by the way, why not join Dan? Ask your instructor about it.